Good morning.
Morning, Lord.
We have a special guest today. We welcome Martha for the first time in many months. Let's give her a hand. Thanks for coming today, Martha. It's a great joy to see you. And it's a joy to see all of you. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to all of you. Welcome to the December 27th, 2020 service for First Congregational United Church of Christ in Zumbrota. It's so nice to see you. Are there any announcements that anyone would like to make at this time? The only thing that I would like to say today is that Arlen talked to me a few weeks ago, and he said that how he enjoyed my talking about the things that I experienced on the way to church on Sundays. And something like that happened to me today. As I was walking Scout early in the morning, it was overcast like it is right now. And it is often really nice to see the sun. But I was thinking this morning that when it's overcast like this, and maybe when there's a little bit of fog, early in the morning, you farmers know this, you get up earlier than I do. But it's really easy on the eyes. There's white of the snow, trees are black, but there aren't a lot of bright colors, and we get tired of that, certainly. But on the other hand, when you get up early and you knock the sleep out of your eyes, there's not a lot going on and jarring you, and it's somewhat comfortable, like a thick blanket is comfortable on a cold winter's night and day. So that is what I thought today. Would you please bow your heads as I give the prayer of invocation, and stand if you are able. Jesus, lead us to be gentle. Let us take our time before speaking and acting. When we speak and act, let us be infused with love and tenderness. Amen. Please join me in singing hymn 105, Gentle Joseph, Joseph Dear. Please be seated and join me in singing hymn 106. my heart sings out with joyful praise. Please sit back in the pews and put your feet firmly on the ground. And feel the strength and the security that you get from the earth. If you want to focus on your breathing, one thing you can do is count the time in for 2, and the breath out for 4, and then in for 4, and out for 6. And focus on that to leave space for God and the Holy to come in. Take some time and come back into our church. Be with one another. Take a deep breath in and let that breath leave. Let's do that one more time as we transition from meditation to hearing the Word of God. There are two readings today. The first reading is on page 604 of the Red Pew Bibles. It is from Isaiah, and the beginning of Isaiah 61 is a very famous passage, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me." And that is what Jesus said in the temple when he began his preaching. But we start at verse 10. Isaiah 61, verse 10 to 62, verse 3. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. The vindication and salvation of Zion. Chapter 62. For Zion's sake I will not keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake I will not rest, until her vindication shines out like the dawn, and her salvation like a burning torch. The nations shall see your vindication, and all the kings your glory, and you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. The second reading will be found on page 947. Paul's letter to the Galatians, chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. And because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, "Abba, Father." So you are no longer a slave, but a child. And if a child, then also an heir through God. Thus ends the reading. My sermon today is entitled, God's Heir. Paul uses the term heir for us. In quite a few places in the Bible, in his different letters, in the scripture that we just read from Galatians, and also in the letter to the Romans, in chapter 8, verses 16 and 17, Paul Paul says that we are heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. So the sermon today is going to be about what that means to be an heir of God. The word heir, as Paul is using it, comes from the Greek, kleronomio, receiver of an inheritance or a beneficiary. And Paul uses that term specifically because what Paul is getting at is this. For Paul, being an heir of God means we receive from God, not because of anything that we do, not because of our acts, but rather because of God's grace through Jesus Christ. It's a specific thing, and it's important for Paul to highlight that we are beneficiaries, that we didn't earn our status as heirs of God. It was a gift to us. The Christian writer Emery Horvath in an article that he wrote that I read about this passage in Romans stressed that for Paul, again, it's not through our actions that we are an heir. It is a gift. And that really is a consistent theme through Paul. And Martin Luther picked up on this theme as well. But I'd like to mention another way that we can view this reading that is not so common, but still has value, I think. There's another way to interpret the word heir. Certainly an heir has legal standing. A person who receives under a will or has a blood relationship to someone. That person is an heir. But there also is a spiritual heir that you might have heard of. And that is somebody who might not be in legal succession, but whose lifestyle and whose goals are the same. For example, Mother Teresa. I don't know a lot about her, but what I know about her is that she is a woman who gave her life and her life's work to help others. And I don't believe that she had any children. But you could say, I think fairly, that someone who did what Mother Teresa did could be called her spiritual heir. Although there isn't a blood relationship, someone who picks up the life's work of Mother Teresa could be described as her spiritual heir. And that is the second way that I want to define heir. And I want to define it that way because of what it leads to. And I'd like you to think about that this week, what that leads to. If we look at ourselves as being God's heir and co-heir with Jesus, that seems to me that what we're doing is putting on the mantle that God has given us and the work for us that God has given us to do. We are heirs of God not only because we've received God's blessings, but because we do God's work. And as Jesus taught his disciples to pray, it's our Father who art in heaven. All of our Father, all of us. Not just Jesus, because Jesus didn't say, "My Father who art in heaven." Jesus said, "Our Father." As you think about that this week, think about what that means and how you live into that. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please use your best outdoor voices, although we're inside, for hymn 127, "Lo, How a Rose Air Blooming." Christmas week is always busy, Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. We often have things to celebrate, and sometimes, regrettably, we have things that make us sad. If you have had good or to you this week, and you want to raise it to us, please do so. We would love to celebrate with you and mourn with you, if that is the way it is. Yes, Martha.
I would like prayers of thanksgiving for all of you and for your prayers and your thoughts and your connection with me over these past 3 months. You know by now that the cancer that had a 50-50 chance of being cured is gone halfway through. And so I'm finishing treatment, but my joy today is that my last treatment will be this Wednesday. So I'm almost through the tunnel. I can see the light at the end of it, and it is not a train coming toward me. So many thanks for healing, for all of you and your prayers and your presence.
Thank you for that good news. Is there anything else? Any other joys or concerns that anyone has? Would you please bow your heads as I give the prayers of the people? Dear God, we come before you today, calm and peaceful day, overcast, and we're surrounded by calm and a moderate temperature, like a blanket, all around us. In the past days, and in the past weeks, and in the past months, we've had a lot of changes, and a lot of good news and a lot of bad news. And we persevere. And like Martha, we keep going. And we do our best. And we live our lives as you would like them lived. At least we try. At least we try. Thank you for the power and healing that you have shown to the world in Martha's life. Thank you for that. Continue to bless her and continue to bless us with her. We pray for those who cannot join us regularly on Sunday mornings. Thank you for their friendship and the love that we feel from them and the love that we send to them. We thank you for the technology that allows people to see our services so that they can drop in whenever it's good for them. us in our worship and in our lives be a blessing to all. God, lift up and strengthen those who suffer in silence, that they may know with certainty that we care for them and love them and would love the opportunity of helping carry their loads. We pray for Connie Holly's father and her family. Bless and strengthen them. Please give your healing grace to Judy Fredrickson as she recovers from surgery. Thank you for our Christmas music and the fact that even though Christmas is past, we're still able to sing a couple of the good old Christmas songs. We pray for the family of Gerald Kylo, Arlen's brother, and we pray for comfort for Arlen, and if possible, please return his beloved dog Coco to him. And if that is not what will happen, God, keep our room in your mind as we do. We pray for gratitude for those who seek the light and remain resilient in the face of this pandemic. We pray for Connie Wynn's daughter-in-law's father, Rich, who had a pacemaker installed. Please help him and his family. We also pray for Connie's sister-in-law, Carol, let her regain the sight that is possible. And increase her vision. We pray for Joan Sand and her partner Dan, who are quarantined with COVID-19. We will keep them in our prayers. Give them your strength. Please join me in praying as Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please stand if you are able, and let us pass the peace, and let us show each other by our eyes how much we mean to each other and how much we love each other. Please join me in singing the peace song, which can be found on the inside of the back cover.
Thank you.
please teach us that what we have is really yours, and what you have is really ours. Amen. Please join me in singing hymn 138 in the black hymnal, Jesus, Our Brother. This week, let's see what happens living that way. Thanks be to God.